here is the first question for Mr. Nilesh Shah. Whopping 20 trillion package has been announced, but it has not been able to cheer the market. Is the package not real? How will the recent stimulus given by government help the revival of the economy?
So one, market is down because of many other factors apart from fiscal and monetary stimulus. There is rising US-China tension. Globally, markets have fallen off. But anyway, in the short term, how market moves is always difficult to decipher. Let's look at our fiscal and monetary stimulus. On the monetary side, RBI is betting like Rohit Sharma in providing liquidity and cutting rates. They have pumped in 8,50,000 crore plus liquidity in banking system. They have cut interest rates by 115 basis points. Now, apart from this, they have done lots of other announcements. Now, obviously, market and borrowers are in ye dil mange mode. But whatever RBI could do, they are doing it. And yet, on ground, results are not coming. Liquidity is with bank, but not with borrowers, as bankers are scared of lending. When I last looked at the number, our total credit growth in 12 months was roughly about 11,03,320 crore between, let's say, 2018 to 2019. In 2019 to 2020, that became 6,48,312 crore. There was a drop of 4,55,008 crore in credit growth in just last 12 months. Credit is the blood of the economy. If there's no credit, there's no growth. So RBI has created liquidity in banking system, but we need to be lucky to move that liquidity from banks to borrowers. If that happens, automatically growth will rebound. If that happens, automatically market will recognize it. Similarly, interest rate cuts have happened on the policy side, but it's not reflected into borrowers' account. If that starts getting reflected into borrowers' account, we will see market capturing that and economy capturing that. On the fiscal side, we have to walk a tightrope. Even if we don't do any stimulus, our fiscal deficit is going to widen because GDP itself will come down and revenues are going to come down even more. Rightfully or wrongfully, we are focused on global rating as it gives confidence to global investors. We have seen Indonesia getting downgraded when they deviated from the path of fiscal prudence. Now, we have to maintain balance between need of fiscal prudence on rating side versus need of Indian economy on fiscal side. We are probably one of the few countries which can fire different bullets to cover damage of coronavirus. On monetary stimulus side, RBI has done a lot, but we can still cut rates by 4 percentage points on repo side. RBI has pumped a lot of liquidity, but we can still pump more liquidity if needed. On the fiscal side, there are needs for out-of-box thinking so that rating is maintained and at the same time we provide necessary support. For example, there is 100,000 crore of assets in custodian of NEB property. Can we monetize that, raise revenue and fund expenditure without impacting deficit? We can also do out-of-box thinking on dead assets of Indian economy, like gold. We have between $1.5 to $2 trillion worth of gold sitting in tijoris of people. Most of it is unaccounted. Now, can we come out with a scheme whereby RBI buys this gold and provides liquidity in the economy? Rating agencies will be fine because expansion of RBI's balance sheet will be backed with gold. People will be fine if they are paid 70% cash upfront for the market value of gold they surrender, and 30% can be paid by way of zero coupon debenture payable after 15 years. The present value cost is very low. That 30 rupee becomes income for the government in today's time when taxation revenues are down. The seller of the gold will go with the mental satisfaction that he is getting 100 rupee back without recognizing net present value loss of 30 rupee. His dead asset becomes part of white economy. He raises equity of 70 rupees plus net present value of 30. Bankers will be happy to lend against that. So in the citizen's hand, we put anywhere between 70 rupee of equity and 70 rupee of debt from bank financing. We put 30 rupee in government's coffers. We expand RBI's balance sheet without receiving any action from rating agency. So we need combination of fiscal, monetary, and out-of-box ideas to minimize damage of COVID-19. Fiscal should be our last choice. Monetary should be our first choice. And that is what is reflected.
Right. Thank you. So my next question is for Mr. Hiren Ved. And, you know, I would like Hiren, you to answer a hand on your heart. We are nowhere close to the lows of 2001 or 2008 or 2013 in terms of valuations. And, you know, everybody, including Mr. Ramdev Agarwal, admitted that, you know, this is absolutely unprecedented event and, you know, maybe once in a century kind of an event. So risk is definitely very high. So, you know, I would like to ask you from the perspective of a lot of investors. So is it so should one sit on cash or, you know, should one invest at these levels, given that risks are very high, but valuations are not really very low, given the historical, you know, averages?
So I think, you know, I think if you talk about valuations, certainly on a PE basis, we are nowhere close to the previous levels that we saw in either 2001 or 2008. But when we had reached near about the lows in March, certainly on a market cap to GDP and on a price to book basis, we were very close to the kind of lows that we saw during the global financial crisis. But having said that, I think whether investors should sit on cash or not really depends on two things. One is, what is the objective that the investor is trying to seek, right? Yes, there is uncertainty without any doubt. I don't think that anybody knows, you know, I think let's even go back 2-3 years when we can say that there was relatively better uncertainty. We started every year with consensus earnings growth of 15% and we landed up at an earnings growth of early single digits, right? So even when there was seemingly better visibility, we got the earnings wrong. Now times are completely uncertain. And therefore, to use valuation as the only benchmark to take a call whether one should invest or not may not be the right thing to do. I think the question that investors should ask to themselves is that, in their opinion and planning, how is their current asset allocation looking like? If you are already overcommitted or reasonably committed to equities, then maybe it may be wise to sit on the sidelines and try not to catch any perceived bottoms or, you know, the markets may look lower from where they were a couple of months ago. But if you are already reasonably committed to equities, you may want to sit on the sidelines for some time. And it is never bad to say that once there is reasonable visibility, I will then risk more capital towards equities. However, if you are significantly underweight, then I think there is a case for you to invest, but very clearly with a long-term perspective. And I would add that investors who are investing today should be mentally ready further uncertainty and maybe even a further downside. So if they can live with a further downside, I certainly believe that if you are investing with a 3 to 5 year view today, equities will give you better returns. Or let me put it this way, that forget the index. If you choose a basket of good stocks, they will definitely give you better returns than that money sitting in your bank account. But I agree with you that there is no harm in keeping cash when times are uncertain. Each investor has to look at his or her current capital allocation. And if he or she believes that we are underweight equities, we should certainly look at allocating over the next few months, because certainly every, you know, history has shown that we will eventually come out of every crisis. What we don't know is whether it gets worse before it gets better. Secondly, for investors who are very, very savvy and have the ability to take uncertainty and risk, it may even be fair to make a tactical allocation to say that, okay, my strategic allocation is already done, but I still have excess liquidity. And should I make a tactical allocation with a 2 to 3 year view? I think possibly yes, because I said that given the trajectory of interest rates, you might make more money in stocks than that money sitting in the bank account. But clearly, you should have the ability to take further. There will be both combination of price correction and time correction. If you are mentally prepared to take both, then I think this is a good time to invest.
Right. So my next question is for Mr. Nilesh Shah. So, you know, at quoting Mr. Hiren Ved as well as Mr. Ramdev Agarwal, who mentioned that we do not have mandate to sit on cash. So we do not sit on cash. Though, you know, it is not unwise to sit on cash depending on one's asset allocation. At the same time, you know, we popularly keep saying, and this is a popular quote, that time in the market is more important than timing the market. Certainly from investors' perspective, timing the market is not a good idea. But, you know, given, you know, that, for example, 2 months ago, we were at a valuations of 29 on PE, which were very high valuations. Wouldn't it be a good idea, learning from, you know, whatever we have seen over last 20, 30 years of our history, that maybe, you know, fund managers should sit on cash at some point of times from the perspective of investors? Because when investors are giving money to the fund managers, we do not want investors to time the market. But wouldn't it be right for fund managers to at least time the market, especially, you know, during such times?
So there are products where fund managers do asset allocation. They are called balance advantage fund. They are called asset allocator product. In asset allocator product, we divide our money based on valuation in debt, equity, and in some cases, even commodities. Now, if you want that call, that fund manager should take a call in terms of asset allocation, those products are already there. But people don't want to invest over there because then the returns are less. You want to have a fund manager who is God. Equity upside, I want full participation. And even one day's correction, you should move 100% into cash. Do you think that is possible? If I had that skill, why will I work? I will be sitting in Nassau, Bahamas and trading for myself. I don't have that skill. That's why I have to do a job. So don't expect unrealistic things from fund managers. We are not God. We are here to outperform benchmark index. If benchmark index goes down 40% and I'm down 30%, I think I have done a great job. And yet, as investor, you lose 30% of the money. But because we have taken these corrections over last so many years, we have delivered great return over a longer term period. We are not traders. We are investors. We are here to outperform benchmark index. I have funds which will remain fully invested to outperform equity indices. I have fund which will divide between equity, debt and commodity to outperform hybrid indices. If you think you don't have risk appetite, please come into asset allocation fund. but then be happy with the returns which asset allocation funds will generate. Don't expect a performance which will give you all the upside of equity and zero downside. That kind of product does not exist in any part of the world.
Thank you, Nilesh. You know, you have really answered, for me, for a lot of our audience and investors, because we keep getting such questions. And I think you really answered this question, bang on. Thank you so much for that. My next question is for Mr. Hiren Ved. So, in good times, we have been seeing valuations of stocks like Bajaj Finance, stocks like Page Industries, stocks like Titan, at obnoxious levels. And, then we have been kind of supporting those valuations by quoting the expected future earnings over decades to come, seeing the management, seeing the brand, seeing the pricing power, seeing the, their order book and all these factors. And now, when this coronavirus thing has hit, we are worried just because the two quarters are going to, go away. And these two quarters going to go away have led to the kind of prices falling by more than 50%. So, if we were to stick to the earlier wisdom of sticking to the quality stocks, even at higher valuations, quoting their future earnings, then definitely the fall in current fall in prices is definitely an opportunity to invest, right? So either the earlier, theory of projecting the future earnings of 10 years and then investing at a PE of 40, 50, 60 was wrong, or, not investing, or maybe, this is the best opportunity to invest at these levels. What are your views in this regards?
See, we have to first understand that valuation is always in a given context. There are several things that go into the valuation. But the most important element of valuation is the certainty of cash flows, the growth, future growth of that cash flows, and the interest rates. Okay. So if you step back a couple of years, I would say, let's say pre-2014-15, FMCG companies would trade at 35-40 times. That was considered high PE. But nominal interest rates were very different at that point in time. If you actually plot the PE chart of the entire market and the subsegments within the market, what we saw post 2014-15 and up until recently is that the PE band of the entire market has gone up, reflecting the lower cost of capital. That is one. Secondly, what has happened, and this is a global phenomena, is that there has been, the markets have tended to become narrower and narrower because there has been a continuous consolidation across sectors. And this consolidation is something which has been happening for a long time. India entered a phase of corporate deleveraging from 2011-2013 onwards, right? And we continuously see that starting with demonetization, then with GST, then with the bankruptcy code, then with RERA, then with ILNFS, now with COVID, all of this is basically saying that there will be even more consolidation in every sector in favor of companies who are able to grow in the current environmental challenges. And therefore, money has gravitated towards those companies because we have not seen a broad-based growth in the economy. We have seen that there is a continuous consolidation within every sector. And companies which are able to take advantage of that consolidation, which means that they are able to grow faster than the nominal growth in GDP or the nominal growth in that sector, have got a disproportionate valuations. So the question we have to ask is that now we have COVID, which has created at least a short to medium term challenge to where the earnings could go in the short to medium term. Yes, I agree that the long-term value of an enterprise should not impact on the basis of one or two quarters of earnings. But it's an assumption, our assumption currently, that it is the disruption is only likely to be for one or two quarters. We really do not know. And what happens is that why prices behave the way they behave. Yes, obviously starting valuations are important, but prices or markets behave like this because markets hate uncertainty. When you cannot price in uncertainty, prices behave the way they have behaved. If in one or two quarters, when the actual numbers come in and investors are able to dimension what is the damage to growth or ROE, even in the short to medium term, then they will reprice the stocks again. But till then, it is only my conjecture and your conjecture, right? So if you talk about the long term, and if we talk about valuations of high quality companies, yes, there are always value. There are reasons why valuations can correct and valuations can go up. And that we should take a view on that sector or particular company. But if you look at general times, I think, do we expect interest rates to go up or go down from here? I think they go down. So that aspect is not going to change. Do we expect consolidation in every sector to continue? I think it is a fair assumption to make that consolidation in every sector will continue. The strong will become stronger in this current kind of an environment. And especially where in many senses, there is true capitalism at work in India right now, which is the survival of the fittest, right? And if investors believe that there are certain companies which are going to be the survival of the fittest, I think that is where the money will gravitate. But there is an intermission right now in the movie. I think the script of the movie is pretty much moving in a one direction where there is continuous consolidation, strongs get stronger, there is more formalization of the economy, cost of capital is falling, but currently access to capital may... Now, because of COVID, you may suddenly find that certain sectors or companies may be in the direct line of fire where earnings may be very uncertain. And therefore, there the valuation damage may continue for a while longer. But in other sectors, we have seen that even though volume growth is down, but the markets have kept the valuations higher. So there is some merit in what the market does. So if you ask me a general perception, I would say that the markets continue to be narrow. I think unless we have broad-based economic growth, then there is a possibility that this lopsided valuations that we saw might reverse. But one should wait and see. In my opinion, currently the markets are only responding to the uncertainty, and therefore nobody knows, you cannot fix the valuation if all other variables are also variable, right? And that's the challenge right now. So, but we should have our mindsets open. Let me give one simple example, right? 5 years or 6 years ago, the generic pharma industry could do no wrong. They were all quoting at 25, 30 multiples. They were compounding profits at 25, 30%. Their ROEs were higher. And then there was a structural change in the business. Even let's say somebody who was a leader in that business, Sun Pharma, which used to trade at 1200 rupees in 2015, in 2019 was at 600 rupees. So it was half from 2015 to 2018. 2019. And then from 2019 to the March lows, it went down even half from there. From 600 to 350 was the bottom. So can you imagine from 2015 to 2020, in 5 years, the stock went from a peak of 1200 to 350 rupees, right? So, but it's a great company. It's a high quality company. But valuations changed because there was a structural shift in the business that happened and the markets derated the multiples. And there may be other reasons, and they derated the multiples of many of the generic pharma companies because there was a structural change. So nothing is static in the stock markets. We, you know, events like this, we have to look out and think and understand whether in companies, they may be the best of companies, but if we believe that there is a structural shift in that business, then there may be that it is possible that they could derate for some time until the until things turn back again. So let's not go with this adage. It's far more complex than to simplistically say that valuations were very high. We should have, who knew what was high valuations? Because I was only willing to pay 25 to 30 times or 40 times for an FMCG company. Now it is normal to see them at 50, 60 times, right? So shift in valuations is not such an easy. We've seen that predicting earnings itself has been so challenging over the last 4 or 5 years. Predicting P's is even more challenging because there are a lot of things that go into P: interest rates, volatility of earnings, certainty of earnings, and so on and so forth. Right. Whether these companies that you mentioned, some of them come back, some of them will come back, may get that valuations again if the growth trajectory resumes, if the ROE is not structurally derated. Now, those are questions which is you have to leave it to the experts and the fund managers to assess. There are no simple answers to that, if you ask me.
Right. Thank you. So, Hiren, you pointed out one point that interest rates are coming down and they have been falling down. So from here, I have a question for Mr. Nilesh Shah. So it is a question, which is linked to economics. So there is a economic theory, which is called expansionary economic theory, which is Keynesian economic theory, which was, drafted during 1930s crisis. And Indian government has kind of behaved in line with that theory by way of announcing a lot of fiscal as well as monetary expansionary policy oriented measures. But the issue is the interest rates are falling. Interest rates have been brought down. They can further go down. But ultimately, banks are not ready to lend. So we are in a times, where interest rates are low, but banks, are reluctant to lend. Question number one, if such reluctance to lend remains, then whatever government does, ultimately, the credit doesn't reach the ultimate, user. And we know that to fuel the economic growth, affordable credit is most important. So wouldn't this accentuate the problem? And how should, government address this particular issue? And what is it that, is stopping? I know the situation is uncertain and unprecedented. That is where banks are not lending. But the entire, theory goes for a toss if the lending doesn't happen.
So essentially, we have to understand why are banks not lending. On one side, we create regulation law, which says that if your check bounces after certain process, you will go behind the bar. There are 4 crore cases of check bouncing, and we don't know how many people are behind the bar. We have to have rules which create equilibrium between lender and borrower. We can't have a situation where on Emirati Hill, you find every single big bank defaulter having a bungalow over there. Second, borrowers have to think, why is someone like Tata able to raise money and never face a challenge from a lender? Because they have always honored their commitment. Even before independence, when Tata still didn't have money to pay salaries in Jamshedpur, Tata family pledged their wife's jewelry, raised money, and put it into public company to pay salaries. When you show that kind of behavior, you build a brand and people lend against that. Today, most of the borrowers don't want to pay their obligations. Tata's put private money in public company to honor their commitments. We have seen borrowers who have taken money from public company for private purpose. The biggest lenders, the biggest defaulter's daughter's wedding, he spent 400 crore. Now we can't have this scenario as a society. So as much onus should be on government and banks, I think there should be more onus on the borrowers and judiciary to create a rule where bankers feel confident of lending money. And in case things go wrong, they should be able to recover money by enforcing security. Lending is a complex thing. When you look at from genuine borrowers, you feel bankers are not doing their job. When you look at from harassed bankers' job, you feel borrowers are taking them for a ride. We need to create rule of law in financial services industry.
Right. So Hiren, you know, now, you know, we'll have a short questions and answers because I want to cover, you know, 4 or 5 more. So what are your views? You know, what sectors are you now confident at if anybody is sitting at cash and is wanting to invest at these levels? So what sectors are you betting on?
See, I think, you know, I say that typically when you have, you know, this is a big event which has happened today, which is likely to probably change, at least for some sectors, the challenges are going to be higher, and for some sectors, the challenges are going to be relatively lesser. And also when you have this kind of a dislocation in the market, yes, it is true, people say that there is likely to be change in sector leadership. However, at this point in time, one thing is very clear that financials as a sector is probably financials and maybe some of the other sectors like airlines, tourism, hotels are in the direct line of fire. And lenders being levered businesses, there is likely to be greater uncertainty around both growth and credit quality. And unless the investors see for themselves over the next few quarters what is the extent of the dislocation, I think these sectors are likely to underperform in the short run. Now, there are no easy answers. I think if I were to simplify this and say, yes, because of this, there will be some new, there are a few contenders, I would say, because leadership changes you get to know over a period of time. Because if there is a massive trend change, the trend lasts for a fairly long period of time. Now, I for one do not know right now whether this is something which is significantly trend changing or the trend continues with a break in the trend, right? Only time will tell that. But having said that, there are a few contenders which are there to take some leadership in the current context. Telecom is one, in my opinion, because I think it is very clear that the post-COVID world is all about data, is all about the way we work, the way we entertain ourselves, the way we communicate with each other. There is a centrality of the mobile network and data, which is going to be very, very important. And behind that, there is a context of an industry which is going through a consolidation and which has probably taken all kinds of regulatory challenges over the last couple of years, right? So at a time like this, when you see that companies break into lifetime highs and some of the telecom players have broken into lifetime highs, it tells you something. So clearly telecom is one of the contenders. We've seen a lot of activity in the pharma sector. I think that there is some case for some re-rating to happen in pharma because of the altered behavior of the US FDA. On one hand, there is some evidence that pricing is stabilizing in one of the largest generic markets. And the fact that generally it was a sector which people went underweight. But it would be an interesting sector to watch and see. I also believe that, you know, there are no, you have to depend on how every manager manages the risk reward within the portfolio, right? So I would say that it is very easy to say that I would be completely underweight sectors which are in the direct line of fire. But if I were to, if I believe that the market tends to, you know, the pendulum swings on both sides. People get very bullish about a sector and then get unduly bearish about a certain sector. I think in if in the next few months, some of these sectors which are in the line of fire, if valuations become so attractive that with a 3 to 5 year perspective, they may actually give you the best risk reward, but the perceived risk in the short run may be the highest. So I think that it is all about how you build the risk reward profile of the portfolio. It's not about swinging completely and saying that I will only own FMCG and pharma in my portfolio and I will have no financials and consumer discretionary stocks, right? So I think it is about how you weight them and what the time horizon is. But I think that certainly there is a case for leadership to come in some sectors. I also am reasonably, you know, bullish. I would say that on autos, because I think that autos was anyways slowing down for some time, even pre-COVID. Inventory in the system was very, very low because of the shifting from, you know, the Euro norms. And now you have the have COVID. So I think once the sector comes back on its feet, and given the fact that interest rates are reasonably low, yes, there may be some impact because of lower demand. But I think last mile logistics is likely to see a significant leg up, because if we are going to use more e-commerce, or if your vegetable vendor or fruit vendor is going to tell you, sir, if you can't come to me, I will deliver it to your doorstep, then I think last mile logistics is likely to get a leg up, both because of e-commerce and the way we are likely to behave over the next few years, and also the positive impulse because of the excess liquidity and lower interest rates, right? So cost of owning a vehicle may come down given the fact that fuel prices are down, interest rates are down, and demand for personal transportation may go up. And so again, I mean, you know, one can go on and on, but I think that there will be a spectrum of opportunities in each sector. And there will be some leadership change, which will certainly happen. I think what is happening right now is that we should differentiate between sector rotation and sector leadership. When markets are uncertain, you also sometimes see that people keep flipping between sectors. You know, with a little bit of time on our side and little bit of visibility, we will be able to see who are the next sector leaders. But there are a few contenders, as I said, it could be pharma, specialty chemicals, telecom, automotive, so on and so forth.
Right. Thank you, Hiren. So, Nilesh, I have a next question for you. So, you know, the situation at present, just give me a second. Yeah. So, given, you know, that at present, valuations are somehow lower than, you know, all-time highs, and huge amount of liquidity has been provided by various central banks. So I had asked this question from Shankar Sharma also, and you know, I had asked him that what is it that could happen suddenly, which could turn things very positive. And he was he had said that if government is able to provide, you know, whopping more than 10 trillion types of package, you know, markets will rebound. So that has happened. Markets have not rebounded. So you know, the current state of investors is that there are some investors, you know, who are under owning equities, they are maybe owning 30% or 50% equities, they can comfortably hold those equities. And but at the same time, they are worrisome. So they are too much fearful. Now, you know, coming back to the, you know, the connection between these two items which I have shared. So what is it that you think could happen, given that there is huge liquidity which has been pumped by various central banks, which could suddenly, you know, make things very positive? And those investors who, you know, remain out of equity or who sit on cash would miss out the probable, you know, expected recovery. Because at present, everybody is kind of bearish. Everybody is, you know, cautious. So market generally, you know, surprises. And that is the reason, you know, prominent investment gurus like Ramdev Agarwalji has been saying that we are nowhere wanting to time the market. We never sit on cash. So what are your, you know, answers to do two pointed questions? What could happen positive, unexpected, and, you know, how would you behave? How would you react to such, you know, situation?
So let's say, apart from the fiscal monetary stimulus and out of box thinking and medical solution, there's one more option to contain damage of coronavirus. That's foreign direct investment. In some sense, market is reflection of economy. If economy grows stronger, eventually markets will follow. Now, we have domestic savings of about 30%. That can help us generate 5, 6, 7% GDP growth. I need to augment my domestic savings with global capital in order to accelerate growth to, let's say, double digit. In 1980, India and China were of similar size. China went on attracting $50-60 billion of FDI every year from 1980 onwards. Today, they are four times bigger than us. They became manufacturer to the world. We were left behind. Now, two of the oldest civilizations of the world, China gave Wuhan virus to the world. We are supplying hydroxychloroquine tablets. 70% of world's vaccine manufacturing is in India. My guess is that no matter who discovers vaccine, he'll have to come to India for manufacturing. So we will supply vaccine to save the world from coronavirus. Ek dard de raha hai, dusra dawai de raha hai. Ek jakham laga raha hai, dusra marham laga raha hai. Will it create tremendous goodwill for India? Answer is yes. Today, Japan, US are announcing packages for bringing their company out of China to their motherland. Can we bring those companies out of China to India? What we missed in the 80s, can we rectify in 2020? There is stiff competition from every nation on the world. Korea, Taiwan, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, Indonesia, Cambodia, Vietnam, Bangladesh, Mexico, they are all giving tough competition. But all these countries put together does not have 1.36 billion consumer. We have 1.36 billion consumer. By leveraging access to local market and by encashing goodwill created by supply of hydroxychloroquine and vaccine, can we bring those companies from China to India, be a part of global supply chain management? And like Y2K helped us become back office to the world, can COVID-19 help us become manufacturer to the world, just like China did in the 80s? These are all possible. Now, obviously, our infrastructure is far inferior compared to others. We have to do structural reforms on land acquisition, labor, infrastructure. But those are all work in progress. In some states, we have already seen labor laws getting relaxed. Essentially, we have two models in front of us. One is Singur model, where Tata Motors struggled and struggled and struggled to set up factory. Finally, it got uprooted. The other is Sanand model, where Suswagatam message went to Tatas. They landed in Sanand. Land was given, power connection was given, approvals were given. 24/7 helpline was there to set up factory. And in 18 months, they started rolling out Nano from their factory. If the whole of India is going to follow Singur model, there is no hope for us. And this is probably the best time to sell whatever equity you are left. If whole of India is going to Sanand model, then this is the best time to invest in equity, because we will become apart from being back office to the world, manufacturer to the world. Now, the way India has behaved in the past and likely to behave in the future, we can only wish for majority of Sanand model and minority of Singur model. Let me conclude by saying what kind of opportunity we have missed. Samsung came to India long before it went to Vietnam. Today it makes in India TV, fridge, AC, mobile phones and sells in India. The turnover is $12 billion in India. It's one of the largest consumer durable companies. Vietnam is 1/10 the size of India. There Samsung came much later after India. They make in Vietnam to sell all over the world. Their turnover in Vietnam is $62 billion, 5 times more than India. They contribute 28% of GDP to India, 28% of GDP to Vietnam. Samsung's importance in terms of contribution to GDP to Vietnam is more than government of India's importance to India's GDP. Now imagine if we had helped Samsung flourish in India like it flourished in Vietnam. Samsung's turnover today in India could have been $72 billion. Their contribution to Indian economy would have been probably 3 to 4% of GDP. If we get 100 such Samsungs and help them flourish just like Vietnam, that's 300, 400% of GDP over a period of time. These are all mathematical calculations on Excel sheet, but we need to execute it on ground. And I'm sure if we are able to use the bullets of fiscal stimulus, monetary stimulus, out-of-box thinkings on monetizing dead assets of India, and really excelling in foreign direct investment, then can the Indian economy be far better than what it is today? Can it be far better than what market is pricing at 9,000 Nifty? Answer is undoubtedly yes. In that scenario, will the world chase India? Answer is yes. So we'll have to become worthy using all the combination of tools which are available to us and ensure that world, which is surplus capital with zero interest rate, starts providing money, and that's how economy and market both will do well.
Thank you, Nilesh. So Hiren, one final question for you. This is the last question. So what are the 2, 3, 4, or 5 positives that you see, you know, as per your insight, in the current scenario?
See, I think this is, as I see things, I think there are a couple of very good positives which are going for India. One is that we have seen that in India, we've been seeing a constant foray of reforms for the last couple of years. But every time there is a crisis, there is an impulse to accelerate that reforms. We have to understand that the reforms that have been carried out over the last couple of years were in the short run growth dilutive, but in the long run were very, very positive for companies, because what Mr. Modi is trying to do is to reduce the cost and improve the efficiency of what you call as the factors of production, which is land, labor, capital. So cost of capital has fallen and is likely to fall even more. There is more formalization of the economy. There is more connectivity of the economy, whether there is focus on, mobile, internet, highways, ports, logistics, small airports. So there is a certain coherent thinking which has gone to drive growth because of productivity in India, right? And I think that a lot of people have this feeling that, our fiscal stimulus is so less compared to what we have seen in the Western world. I think I would look at it slightly differently. If I would put this argument on its head, I would say we should consider ourselves lucky that we have got 1 to 1.5% of GDP as a fiscal stimulus combined with massive liquidity infusion into the system. And had COVID not happened, not that I wish COVID would happen, but now that it has happened, had COVID not happened, we wouldn't have probably got this, right? Maybe monetary liquidity was anyways happening, but fiscal stimulus, probably not to the extent that we have got now. So I think we have to, there is a saying, ke jo bhi hota hai, achhe ke liye hota hai. I would say that would we have, you know, this government has always been fiscally responsible and conservative for all the right reasons. But would we have got 1.5% or 1% or 1.2%, whatever is the calculation of GDP as a fiscal stimulus had COVID not happened? I don't think so. So I think that post-COVID, we will have this opportunity of a monetary stimulus, a fiscal stimulus, and as Nilesh rightly said, a far greater context where FDI in India can come in. I think there is a significant, there is a value to the kind of, I would say, eco-diplomacy, economic diplomacy that Mr. Modi has carried out in the last couple of years, where he's been friends. He's equally a great friend of of Trump, as well as he's a good friend of Putin. And he's also been friends with, our friends in the Middle East. And the idea is that he will leverage this relationship, plus with the kind of narrative that is building up in China. I certainly see that there will be significant foreign direct investments that will come into the country. In fact, I'm more bullish on FDI than FPI flows at this point in time, right? So I think what you have is an economy which is more formalized. Yes, we have taken a lot of shocks in the last couple of years, but I think we will get a far more productive economy going forward from here with all the factors of production, which will be in favor of entrepreneurs. That is one. Secondly, I think that one of the watershed movements is that you are beginning to see that states have begun to take the mantle of reforms. We always think that reforms are driven from the top. I think the story in India over the next few years is going to shift to the states. Look at how UP, MP have moved on labor reform. Would we have ever dreamt that this would happen? I don't think so. Look at what Karnataka has done on agricultural land, right? I think that, every time there is a crisis, it gives us an impulse to do some structural reforms. And I think there has been something which is very, very significant, which has been done on the agri side in terms of opening up or dismantling of the APMC framework, which will give significant dynamism to agriculture and the rural economy, right? So I think that, we are now starting from a base where we have more liquidity than we had. We have lower interest costs than we ever had, where we have a more formalized economy than we ever had, and a tailwinds of geopolitical realignment and FDI coming into the country. So I think that there are positives which are clearly there. And now we have competition among states to compete and attract investments and create the right climate for investments to come in by, we are starting to work at what were called the holy cows in reforms. Land reforms, labor reforms, and agri reforms. Nobody wanted to take these hard calls, right? Look at what Mr. Modi has done when he allowed the states to borrow more. it's a carrot with a nudge or a stick to say, hey, you know, reform your ease of doing business, you know, make everything online, you know, work on your power policies to reduce inefficiency on the distribution side. These are all good elements. You know, we will only see the benefits of this in the medium to long term, but I think the benefits will be significant. So I think that it's a tough time. It is uncertain, but I think in general, if you ask me, Indians thrive in uncertainty. You know, I remember when demonetization happened, we said, oh God, what's going to happen? 85% of people's cash is impounded. Yes, there was disruption. Yes, there was difficulty. But, you know, you have to bet on the ingenuity of the of Indians and Indian entrepreneurs. I think what is required in the current context is that once the biggest stimulus for us is going to be the opening up of the economy and the government and the state machinery getting out of our lives slowly and steadily. As they move out of our lives and allow us to do what we are best at, I think Indian entrepreneurs are very, very adaptable, very resilient, and I have no reason to see that we will bounce back. Plus, with all of the tailwinds that I mentioned, monetary, fiscal reforms, FDI, you know, I think which are tailwinds for us. So I would look at, just as Mr. Buffett has always said, that, you know, you never go wrong betting on America, no matter what the short-term challenges and circumstances are. I'm of the belief that you have to bet on India, on its entrepreneurs. And, you know, you won't go wrong. I mean, you may have a tough time in the near term, but I think the long term, to my mind, is clearly positive.
Thank you, both of you. It has been insightful talking to you. And I would just like to summarize by, you know, reminding everyone about Warren Buffett's quote, which may not be, you know, entirely apt at this point of time, but, you know, it has been written for these times, which is, when everyone is fearful, it's time to be greedy. Maybe, you know, one may not be greedy, but one can certainly not ignore so many tailwinds, which have been highlighted by both Mr. Nilesha and Mr. Hirenve. 2 months ago, we were all wanting to invest into equity, and we were seeing all these structural moves, structural steps being taken by Indian government, Indian policymakers. And we were of the view that, yes, these, you know, financials, these valuations are supportive because of so many economic structural moves being taken. Now we cannot forget, you know, some of those. Maybe COVID-19 has come as, you know, a fortune for a lot of investors who are undergoing equity and who are wanting to invest at these levels. So with these positive remarks, I would like to move on to the next session. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
I would just say that I would change it. Don't be greedy when others are fearful. Be cautiously optimistic when others are fearful. I would say, yes, be cautious, but be optimistic.
Sure. Thank you.